Good evening, everyone. Welcome to Sips and Science.
Yes, good evening. This is Josh Parker, and I just want to say welcome. And I see some familiar names, and I'm excited to see a lot of new ones tonight. Thank you for joining us this evening. We are glad to have you here and host you virtually. Now, we do record the lectures, and they will be available later for viewing on the Brain Health YouTube page. And we will be having a Q&A with the speaker at the end of the presentation. Please be sure to post your questions on the speaker in the Q&A box located in the toolbar. Now, I'm excited that this is the first Sips and Science on the 21st day of the 21st year of the 21st century. I thought that was just a cool little thing I learned today. So I'm also excited to introduce you to Jennifer Zients, our deputy director and head clinician at the Brain Performance Institute. She's going to moderate tonight's event.
Yeah, thanks, Josh. Welcome, everybody. For those of you who are new, and even as a reminder for those of you who have been here before, Sips and Science is our lecture series that is put on by the Brain Performance Institute at the Center for Brain Health as a way to make brain research accessible to the public. So when Josh said that we'll have a Q&A at the end, absolutely, please post your questions. This is such a hot topic. I know that there's going to be lots and lots of questions. And so without further ado, I want to introduce our speaker, Dr. Kirk Erickson. We are so excited and honored to have him tonight. Dr. Erickson is an associate professor at the University of Pittsburgh. He's currently the director and principal investigator of the Brain Aging and Cognitive Health Laboratory at Pitt. He is an expert in exercise and brain health and performance. And very proudly, we can say he is one of our collaborators on the Brain Health Project. And so for all of you who are part of the project or you're thinking about joining, we're all going to be able to benefit and contribute. We're going to be able to benefit from Dr. Erickson's work, and we're going to be able to contribute to the growing literature and all the things that we don't know yet about exercise and brain health. Dr. Erickson's work extends across the lifespan. He studies health. He studies brain disease and disorders. His work has been funded in the millions. He has over 230 publications. He mentors students, and he still has time to play squash and to go salsa dancing. And one of the things, interestingly, is that Dr. Erickson was supposed to be on sabbatical this year. And so one of the graces of pandemic is that he stayed mainland US, which is lucky for us tonight and lucky for everyone to be able to hear from Dr. Erickson. So welcome, Dr. Erickson, and we cannot wait to hear from you tonight.
Thank you. Thank you so much. It's a really nice introduction, and I'm very honored to be here, to be able to present some of the work and some of the material to you today. Let me go ahead and start my presentation. So thank you again. It's really wonderful to be here. I'm very honored to be presenting to you today, and I'm very honored to be a part of this fantastic center and the work that's going on here and being thought of as an important collaborator and contributor to the project. Brain health is my passion. It's what I do. It's what I've been interested in for many years now, and I'm hoping to be able to convey some of that passion to you, give you some understanding of why it's so important to be thinking about brain health, and in particular, why exercise seems to be such an important factor to contribute or to think about when we are thinking about brain health. It's a really important aspect of our lifestyles that influence our brains and how we think. So starting off, the title here, Walk Like a Greek, Think Like Aristotle. And let's start out actually talking about Aristotle. Aristotle, all the way back to the early Greeks, they were thinkers, obviously, but a very important part of their philosophy was to have a healthy body, and to engage in regular physical activity in order to maintain excellent health, and not just excellent health from a physical perspective, but also excellent mental health. They were some of the first individuals that really were linking together the importance of maintaining physical health for the maintenance of mental health. Now, it's not just Aristotle who was a main proponent of physical activity. In fact, many Greeks and Greek city-states and the people within the Greek city-states were fans of exercise in many of its forms. Of course, as shown here, they were also not bashful about exercising in the nude, which I will allow you to ponder whether exercising in the nude has any added beneficial effects. I don't think we know, but they did exercise in the nude. But if we move beyond that and think a little bit more broadly about Plato and Aristotle, Plato and Aristotle certainly had differing philosophical views, but one area where they really came together and agreed was the importance of maintaining physical health, maintaining a physically active lifestyle for the maintenance of overall health, and that included mental health as well. So Plato once wrote, "Beauty and health require not only education and knowledge, but also gymnastics." There's others throughout history, however, have not had the most optimistic or enthusiastic perspective about physical activity or exercise. For an example, Mark Twain once wrote, "I take my only exercise acting as a pallbearer at the funerals of my friends who exercise regularly." So of course there's various viewpoints, and Mark Twain in his humorous fashion points out one of the characteristics that a lot of people just don't like exercise. They don't like the term exercise. It's difficult to engage in. We're gonna come back to this throughout the talk about the best ways of trying to maintain a physically active lifestyle. Since Mark Twain, of course, throughout the 20th century, we've shifted our views of exercise quite a bit because of the science. We've gone away from anecdotes about the benefits of exercise and really moved to the science. And the science really started out in forms of trying to understand whether exercise increases or decreases risk for cardiac events. And then it exploded into many other areas. So we know from the scientific fields many of the benefits, the health benefits of exercise on a variety of different outcomes, including lifespan in general. But it's only been fairly recently where we've really started to target the brain as a central organ that could be affected by engaging in just regular amounts of modest exercise. So this is really where brain health comes onto the stage in relation to engaging in exercise. Over the last couple of decades now, there's been a considerable amount of work, and especially I would have to say in the last 5 to 10 years, there's really been an explosion of work in this area. And I'd like to remind you of a few reasons why that's the case. Exercise is free. Doesn't require a patent, or you can't patent exercise. And because of that, it's very cost effective. It's highly accessible to many, many people, not just in the United States, but around the world. So there are many countries that are very, very interested in exercise as medicine because of how many people it can potentially reach. That's a very, very important aspect that so many other types of interventions and ways of trying to influence our health are just incapable of doing. So when we start thinking about this aspect of physical activity and its impact on brain health. We also can think a little bit about the policies, the public health policies that could emerge from some of this science that I'm going to be sharing with you today. In fact, a few years ago, I was elected to be on the Physical Activity Guidelines for Americans Committee. This was a committee put together by our federal government to evaluate how much and what types of physical activity could benefit certain outcomes, certain health outcomes. And the brain was one of those outcomes that was really central on the agenda for the physical activity guidelines. And so I'm very happy to say that in 2018, we came out with the Physical Activity Guidelines for Americans, second edition, and brain health was a central part of this. So for the first time, we really have guidance about utilizing physical activity to influence various aspects of the brain. And what did this report tell us? Or what did it focus on? One thing that it focused on is aspects of brain health that we consider to be more cognitive in nature. So memory function, your ability to selectively attend to certain things in your environment and ignore other things, your decision-making, your reasoning, all of these aspects of cognitive function were examined. How does exercise and physical activity relate to these aspects of brain function? But we also examined aspects of mood, depression, anxiety. How does exercise positively influence, or does it positively influence, these measures, these outcomes? We also examined measures of quality of life, your perception of how well you're actually doing, your overall well-being. And finally, we also examined aspects of sleep. Sleep is such an important aspect of our overall functioning. And when we're fatigued, we might not be thinking as well, we might not feel as well, we might feel more depressed, et cetera, et cetera. And so sleep is such a critical component, and could exercise be an effective way to improve aspects of sleep? So we looked at a variety of these outcomes. And overall, I can tell you that our recommendation is that physical activity is actually a very effective approach for all of these things. So if you're interested, there are now scientific reports that have been generated as a result of the physical activity guidelines. This is one paper that was published in 2019, summarizing our work on this committee specifically in relation to cognitive outcomes. The overall picture, I'm going to give you one of the punchlines here. The overall picture is that there is unequivocal evidence that physical activity influences the brain. That is no longer an argument. We know that physical activity is an effective approach for influencing the brain. What we're now debating, what we're now discussing, are some of the subtleties of how exactly physical activity influences the brain, how much do you need to get, what type of physical activity, and so on and so forth. I'm going to be talking a little bit more about some of these questions over the course of my presentation here, the next few minutes. So one of the questions that comes up, and that came up during the course of our the Physical Activity Guidelines Committee, and that continuously comes up in scientific discussions, is do the effects of exercise on the brain vary depending on how old you are? And the idea here is pretty straightforward. We have our lifespan from infancy up through late adulthood. What do we know about how exercise influences these different time periods of our life? Early in childhood, our brains are in these developmental phases where the brain is highly plastic, going through sensitive and critical periods of development, where it's crucial that certain things happen at certain time periods to really influence future development. On the other side of the life course, in late adulthood, we experience brain atrophy and brain deterioration and losses in some cognitive function and increased risk for dementia and Alzheimer's disease and some other neurologic conditions. And so these are very important questions to ask about when or what time point in life is exercise most effective. Well, let's start here just down at the age range of about 5 years old and less than 5 years old. We really don't have very good science or scientific information in general about any possible effects of exercise, or should we say physical activity, that could be benefiting brain development at this age. Doesn't mean that it's not happening. It's just that we don't have good science right now to understand if it's happening, could it have any beneficial effect? We just simply don't know. So I'm going to make an X through that by the baby, because we just simply don't know whether exercise is going to be effective. If we look a little bit older in the pre-adolescent period, maybe between 7 and 12 years of age, here is where there's actually a lot of work being done right now. So we actually have a very good sense of the amount of work that's being done. We have a very good sense from it that physical activity, exercise, is very beneficial for a variety of different brain functions. I'm going to get to a few slides on this in the next few minutes. If we move up a little bit older to adolescence, teenage years. Like infants, teenagers, we simply don't have a whole lot of information about this. Partly, like infants, it's partly because of compliance issues. It's difficult sometimes for some of these populations to comply with our requests of getting a certain amount of exercise per week. And so, unfortunately, we just have insufficient data available at this point for us to be very confident about positive effects of exercise on brain health or brain function in this age range. It's growing. It's a hot area, but I say we can't make any strong claims. When we move up into young adulthood or midlife periods, here we can be a bit more confident about some of the positive effects of exercise on various aspects of brain function, including cognition and mood and sleep. If we move up a little bit further, late adulthood, here too, this is actually where the bulk of the evidence really comes from. And here we can be very confident that exercise has a number of different very positive effects on the brain. And we're going to be covering a few of those points in the next few slides. So overall, we have a good sense. We know where some of the gaps are, and we know where there's a bit more stronger and more consistent evidence for some of the benefits to occur. Like I said earlier, I want to draw your attention. I want to make you aware that absence of evidence is not evidence of absence. So what I mean by that is simply that just because we don't have data available yet for children under 5 years of age doesn't mean that physical activity in some capacity wouldn't be beneficial. We're just lacking the evidence right now. So let's start here earlier in the lifespan, pre-adolescent time periods. Do we have data available to demonstrate that physical activity really has some powerful effects on the brain? Now, I'm going to be talking about a few different brain areas, but one of them is the hippocampus. The hippocampus is an area sitting kind of behind your ears and towards the center of the brain. It's critically involved in memory formation. It grows early in childhood. It's involved in memory formation, but in late adulthood, it starts to shrink. It starts to show some deterioration, and that's what's thought to lead to some of the memory impairments that older adults experience. And in fact, some of the risk for dementia and Alzheimer's disease comes through loss of hippocampal size and function. So the hippocampus is really critical all through the lifespan. And what we've learned is that exercise seems to influence this particular structure. In children, here you can see in orange the hippocampus on this brain image. And what we can see is that in pre-adolescent children, higher fit children have larger hippocampal volumes than their lesser fit peers. They're age-matched peers. They're just lesser fit. Now, this is a very important finding that is also translated to memory function. In fact, what you're seeing here in terms of relational accuracy, relational memory performance, is the type of memory supported by the hippocampus? And what we see here is that higher fit children also perform better on this memory test. So larger hippocampal volume seems to translate to better memory function. This is really important. Now, what we don't know yet is whether exercise, whether physical activity at this period of life alters long-term developmental trajectories, the path that you're on. We still don't have a good sense of that. There's still a lot of work, a lot of questions yet to answer. We can also look at from interventions, when we take people in, we take these kids in and we get them physically active, generally after school, we get them physically active, we get them exercising, and we see changes in different aspects of brain function. So on the left-hand side here of the screen, you can see the kids that were participating in physical activity for several months after school showed improvements, increases in brain function across two different types of cognitive tasks. And these changes, like I said earlier, seem to translate into better performance. So we're seeing changes on the biological brain level that translate into better memory function, better cognitive performance. From a broader perspective, let's take a step back here. What's really important at this age is academic performance. It also seems to be that kids who engage in physical activity, participate more in physical activity, tend to have better academic performance and academic achievement scores. This is really, really a very important point, especially considering that there's some political perspectives that say that we should be pulling physical education out of the curriculums for these kids. We should be pulling recess out of the curriculums for these kids. And what the data is suggesting is that that should not happen, that physical activity, physical education, and recess might be actually critical components to their educational performance, their academic performance. So with that, you might say, exercise? I thought you said extra fries. Of course, diet plays a very important role in brain health. For the sake of time, I'm not going to be discussing it here, but you might also be thinking in these pre-adolescent kids, we're also seeing increased rates of obesity. Absolutely. And we know that obesity has a negative impact on the brain. There's growing amounts of data indicating this. So I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this, but we do know diet should be taken into consideration when we're thinking about the effects of physical activity on brain health as well. So let's move. What do we know about late adulthood? Here, there's even a lot more data, a lot more evidence. Unfortunately, as we start thinking about late adulthood, we have to take into consideration the finding, the very, very common finding that as we get older, we start showing some decrements, some decreases in our cognitive function. And this is not just in memory performance, it's fairly ubiquitous across many different cognitive domains. As I'm showing you here, right around the age of 60, give or take, it's when we start to see some gradual decline in our cognitive performance. Now, these cognitive changes are actually preceded by a number of changes happening in the brain. So the hippocampus, we've come back to the hippocampus, the same region that I showed you earlier in the context of pre-adolescent children. This region starts to deteriorate as we get older. It starts to shrink. And this shrinking of the hippocampus is what is thought to lead to some of the memory impairments and risk for Alzheimer's disease. It's not just the hippocampus that shrinks. There are other areas. So for example, in the bottom slide here, the bottom image is showing you the prefrontal cortex. This is in the frontal part of your brain. It's involved in what we refer to as executive functions, supporting attention, working memory, planning, coordination, all of these types of activities. And we see this prefrontal cortex region also shrink with age. So what do we know about the effects of exercise on these aspects of brain health in late adulthood, in late life? What do we know? Well, we know, and this is now from quite a few studies that have randomly assigned people, older adults, into either an exercise condition in which they come into the lab, they exercise at a particular dose for a particular frequency over a several month period, anywhere from 3 to 6, even 12 months in duration. They come back repeatedly and they participate in these studies. I'm running many of these studies now. What we can be confident about is that these types of studies really show significant improvements in cognitive performance. Now, I want to repeat that. Remember, starting to engage in exercise, starting to do some exercise in late life, even when you've been sedentary, can improve function. It's never lost, it's still there. You can take advantage of this and actually improve brain function. This is a slide that shows 4 different cognitive domains: executive, controlled, spatial, and speed. The exercise groups are in yellow, the control groups are in blue. What you're seeing here are 2 really important things. One is that the yellow bars are all larger, are all higher than the blue bars, indicating that exercise seems to have this fairly broad effect across many different cognitive domains. Most cognitive domains show some improvements with exercise. But there also seems to be some specificity. Some cognitive functions seem to be affected more than others. What's happening in the brain? Well, let's come back to the hippocampus, our favorite region here that we've been talking about throughout the talk so far. When we look at the hippocampus, what we see is, just from a correlation perspective, we see that individuals that are higher fit, and generally higher fit individuals are people that who have engaged in exercise more habitually. They've maintained an exercise or physically active lifestyle for some long period of time that has allowed them to have a more higher score on a cardiorespiratory fitness test. So what we see here is that those individuals, those older adults, these are all people over between 65 and 80, 85 years of age. These individuals that are higher fit tend to have larger hippocampal volumes than their lesser fit peers, a very similar pattern that we saw that I mentioned earlier in children. We're seeing the same effect in older adults. In fact, what's really striking is that now this particular finding that was originally published in 2009 has actually been replicated numerous times across different populations and different age groups. So this seems to be a common finding. Higher cardiorespiratory fitness levels tend to be associated with larger hippocampal volumes. And again, hippocampus critically involved in supporting memory function. So how about if we get people exercising? Here too, we did this. This was a 1-year exercise intervention. We brought people in, we got them exercising at the frequency, the intensity, the volume, exactly what we wanted them to do. We monitored their performance, we monitored their intensity and everything. And what did we find? We found that engaging in 12 months of just moderate intensity exercise, most of these older adults were walking. So they were just walking. A brisk walk is what we're talking about here. That resulted in an increase in hippocampal volume. Now, what I want you to take home from this is really critically important here, is that this demonstrates a remarkable degree of neuroplasticity. Remember, only what we're finding here is only modest amounts of exercise for 12 months was capable of reversing this age-related decay of the hippocampus. What's really striking about this is that pharmaceutical companies have yet to be able to demonstrate this with drugs. A good pair of walking shoes was able to do something that pharmaceutical companies have invested a lot of money in and have failed repeatedly. Now, this particular effect has been replicated. In fact, we just published a meta-analysis. I'm not going to focus, don't focus all on the numbers, but rather on the red circle down at the bottom. What we see when we look across many different interventions now, interventions for schizophrenia patients or ADHD children or older adults or kids, what we see across the board is that exercise has a small but significant effect on altering the size of the hippocampus. Across all of these studies, it's a significant effect. So you might be asking yourself, okay, great, this sounds really great, very promising, very provocative, but exactly how does exercise affect the brain? What you're asking there, if you're asking that question, what you're asking is a mechanism question. You're asking exactly what are the pathways by which this happens? It's a very important question. You might be thinking right away, there's got to be some molecular pathways, some cellular changes that are happening, and you're probably right. But what's really important is that we could list out probably hundreds of different molecules that are likely to be affected by exercise that in turn is influencing the brain and cognition in the ways that we were just describing. In other words, there's not just one single molecule at work. We can also think about all of these other aspects of the brain that are probably working in tandem, working together to alter what we consider to be brain function, the key components. We're talking about depression and mood, or we're talking about memory and cognition or sleep. All of these things are likely coming together in some way to influence these behavioral outcomes. Also, we have to remember that these things are interchangeable. So for an example, exercise might be a good way of getting you to sleep better, and sleep might also improve your memory. So all of these things we have to be thinking about as a whole. And that's a really important point, and that's part of the reason why sometimes I refer to exercise as a sledgehammer. It's a sledgehammer effect on the body. There's not a single organ, not a single system that isn't affected in some positive way by engaging in exercise. And so what does that mean? Part of the reason why I think exercise is having such a profound effect on children, on older adults, across the lifespan, and in clinical populations, many clinical populations, is precisely because there is not one single mechanism at play. It's affecting so many things, like a sledgehammer. It's affecting so many things that just about everybody has the potential to benefit from engaging in exercise. So you might also be asking a very important question. How much exercise do you need? What you're really asking here is a dose question, right? So when we go to the doctor, we get prescribed some medication and we have a dose. We know exactly how much that pill, how much of the medication is in that pill, how many pills to take, how frequently to take that medication, and so on. So if we're going to be thinking about exercise as medicine, then it's going to be very important for us to come up with some prescriptions for people. How much do we need to achieve to see these brain benefits? Now, that sounds like a fairly simple question, but it's actually a very complex answer. Obviously, we can't prescribe the same amount of exercise for a 12-year-old child as we would for an 80-year-old adult. Even within older adults, somebody who has dementia might have to receive a much different dose of physical activity than somebody who doesn't have dementia. So there's that population characteristic. We might also realize, we might also find out that the amount of exercise that you need to change the hippocampus is different than the amount of exercise that you need to change the prefrontal cortex. In addition, what do we mean by how much? Are we talking about the intensity of exercise? Are we talking about the minutes of exercise that you get per week? Are we talking about the frequency of exercise? Does exercise have to be done in at least 10-minute bouts or longer? How much do you need? When you ask how much of this exercise do you need, we have to be thinking about all of these parameters of exercise. And that's where it starts to become very difficult to answer. Here's a few hints though. Generally, what most people are saying right now is that you should be aiming for at least 150 minutes per week of moderate intensity exercise. What that means for most older adults, for an example, is a brisk walk. Generally, moderate intensity is if you can, after engaging in moderate intensity exercise, you still may be able to talk, but you might not be able to sing. So that is where we're talking about moderate intensity exercise. But what if you do vigorous? If you do some vigorous, can you do less moderate and get the same benefit, the same brain benefit? These are really important questions. Another really important point that I want to make sure that you all take home is that some exercise is always better than none. So if you come to Friday, tomorrow's Friday, and if you say, I didn't exercise at all, so I'm just giving up for this week, it's not the right perspective to take, because even 10 minutes of exercise has been shown to be better than none. So if you can at least get 10 minutes in, then get 10 minutes. So some exercise is always better than none. So here's some just general tips for behavior change. Go slow. Make realistic goals for yourself, especially if you're just starting out with an exercise routine, an exercise regimen. Go slow. Be realistic about the time that it's going to take, the dedication. Don't think that you're going to become a marathon runner overnight. This doesn't happen. And so make realistic goals. Find an activity that is enjoyable. You know, one thing that for some reason happens when we become adults is that that exercise is no longer play for many of us. It's no longer a playtime. When I was a kid, I remember my parents telling me to go outside and play. They didn't say go out and exercise. They said go out and play. For some reason, when we become adults, many of us don't think of it that way. We change the terminology. We think of it now as exercise. It's a different way of thinking about it. But we have to remember, this is supposed to be an enjoyable activity. We have to find things that are enjoyable. And what we know is that if we're going to stick to something, if we're going to adhere to some activity, it has to be enjoyable. I'm not going to continue to do something that I hate doing. Plain and simple. Get friends to join you. We know is that adherence tends to be better when it's group activities. If you know that your friend is waiting in the park for you at 7 o'clock in the morning, you're going to make sure that you're not going to let your friend down. You're going to be there for that person. Monitor your activity. We now have Fitbits. We have a lot of different devices that can monitor our activity. Utilize that information. Examine how your activity levels have changed over the course of several weeks, month, or several months. Some of these things can really act as incentives and positive reinforcement for continuing to exercise. And finally, be patient with this. We all have things, we all have life events that can interrupt and disrupt our lives. Keep going, be patient. So in conclusion, exercise has widespread effects on the brain across the lifespan and across many different populations. What I didn't really get a chance to tell you here today is that exercise is now being utilized in schizophrenia, in ADHD. We have studies in depression. We've got studies in breast cancer. Women with breast cancer are showing cognitive benefits from exercise. We're showing this across many different populations, and this is coming back to my point about the sledgehammer. Exercise is like a sledgehammer. That's why everyone seems to be affected by it. Moderate intensity exercise several days a week is sufficient for improving brain health. You don't need to do a lot in order to start seeing the benefits. Starting to exercise in late life is not futile. Even those who are sedentary can improve function. This is an important component. Sometimes I have people tell me, I have never exercised in my life. What could I possibly benefit at this point from exercise? And actually, there's some evidence to suggest that those people that are more sedentary might benefit even more. So actually, go out and exercise. That's not an excuse. And finally, like I was mentioning, exercise may have long-term health consequences for many different diseases and conditions of the brain. And so really, there's no reason to not exercise. And it's good for the heart, it's good for the body, it's good for the brain. So in conclusion, I just want to thank my entire team, my funding agencies, my collaborators, too many of them to name here. And thank you again for your attention allowing me to discuss some of these findings for you. So thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Erickson. Okay, we have lots of questions. Great. So first off, I want to talk about some of the things you just were talking about, kind of what you ended, I want to hit on the point you just ended on, which was that exercise can help with brain disease. Mm-hmm. So Let's take Alzheimer's disease, for example. So we've seen clearly there's benefit to the hippocampus, to memory function. Can talk about the impact of exercise before, you know, as a protective type of measure, as well as once diagnosis, you know, for somebody either who has been exercising or who never exercised, and now they've been diagnosed and they're having, they're having memory problems. They've reached diagnosis. Now what, you know, and can that help? And how does that help?
Yeah, that's an excellent question. It brings up the two very important terms here, prevention and treatment or therapy, right? And so you're absolutely right. We should be thinking of physical activity as a way of preventing Alzheimer's disease from occurring. And there's actually a great deal of data demonstrating that engaging in regular amounts of physical activity throughout your lifespan tends to be associated with a reduced risk of developing Alzheimer's disease. So we can be pretty confident, actually very confident, that that is one way of reducing your risk for developing the disease. Now, in terms of a therapy, in terms of a treatment, there have been numerous studies indicating that engaging people with dementia can also improve many aspects of brain function, but including memory function. Now, I have to say that there is more mixed evidence in this area, I would have to say, at this point. And there might be several reasons for that. As you might expect, engaging individuals with dementia can sometimes be more of a challenge than engaging individuals without dementia into exercise. And so there's a lot more safety, comorbidity concerns, other issues that really make those studies a lot more difficult. And so there's some good reasons for why there's some muddiness in that literature, but the evidence is all pointing in a very positive direction right now.
Awesome. Another thing, on one of your slides, when you were talking about the benefit of kind of aerobic activity on the hippocampus and then stretching. So this was a question that I had definitely, and I've already seen many people having the same question. The line with aerobic activity looks like it's going up, there's gains, but then the red line with the stretching was going down. So talk about that, talk about the impact of stretching. And then also I wanna know if there's research, if you've done research or what's the state of the research looking at the impact of both together.
Yeah, that's a very astute observation.
Okay, and can I add one more thing to that last point?
Of course, of course.
Also about weight training, like into that as well. But first, just talk about the aerobic versus stretching. Thanks.
Sure, sure. Yeah, like I said, that's a very astute observation. There, we did see in that particular study, we did see a slight decline in hippocampal volume in the stretching and toning group. That was a group that was designed to be the control group. We wanted them to still come in, receive some social interaction. We wanted them to still come in and get some health instruction, but we didn't want them to get a higher intensity, moderate intensity, get their heart rate moving. We didn't want them to achieve that level. So it was a manipulation of intensity. So we kept them stretching and toning, and not even really toning, it was more stretching related activities, to really just keep them somewhat active, but at a light level. So what we believe is happening here is that decline over that 1 year period was actually normal aging and actually aligns well with other data indicating that, just observational studies indicating that as we get older, the hippocampus shrinks. That's exactly what we saw in the stretching and toning group. Now, combining aspects of more resistance strength training with aerobic training, I'm a big fan of this approach. In fact, there was a meta-analysis published a number of years ago indicating that those studies that combined those approaches tended to have larger effect sizes than just aerobic or just resistance. So we do have some good data coming out now that resistance or strength training can by itself have a pretty profound impact on the brain, and it might actually be working through several different pathways than what aerobic activity is working through. So there's some interesting ideas here about bridging them or merging them together and essentially reaping the benefits of what both can provide. There's still a lot of work in that area. Most studies either do just resistance and strength training or just aerobic.
So what about, I know you were talking about that particular study with the aerobic exercise and the stretching was a year long.
Yeah.
How long can we see? I know, you know, following study participants over a long time is difficult work. How long can we expect to see benefits? Is this a situation where as long as you keep doing it, you're going to keep getting the benefit? And like, if you were to stop exercising, what would be the greatest loss?
These are very, very good questions. So first of all, generally, let me address your last question first, actually. My own perspective on this, my own belief, and that we still need to collect data on this. So this is my speculation, we should say, on this. My belief is that in general, behaviors have to be maintained in order to continue to reap the benefits, right? So in the same way as, think of a diet. You go on a diet, you change your dietary habits, you lose weight, but if you start changing your dietary habits back to what they were previously, you're probably going to gain all that weight back. It's the same thing, it's probably the same thing with exercise. If you start exercising, you're going to reap the benefits of that. If you stop, go back to a more sedentary lifestyle, those health benefits are probably going to be returning to what they were previous to starting to exercise. Now, again, this is speculation because we really need more studies, and I think you're hinting at this, we really need more studies that continue to follow people after the course of these interventions in order to really be confident about this. We really don't have that. And unfortunately, a lot of our funding mechanisms generally have it such that we do an intervention, we get funded for the intervention, and then we have to apply for separate funding to continue to monitor them over the course of time. So it can be challenging that way. Your first question, coming back to your initial question on how long could the benefits actually persist, is another really important unanswered question here that is very critical. And when we think about the brain, just the brain volume measures, let's say that the hippocampus, does in fact increase in volume in older adults when you're exercising. Obviously, the hippocampus cannot continue to increase in size. We are limited by our skulls, so our brains cannot just simply increase forever, perpetually increasing if you engage in exercise. So at some point, we're going to be reaching a plateau in what exercise can do. It's also, and I also want to make sure that we realize here that exercise is not a magic bullet for everything, right? So we were mentioning that exercise might be a way of improving function in dementia, but it might not be a way of eliminating dementia. I'm not saying that. I don't think anyone is saying that. And so we have to be realistic. And what it's capable of doing. We can might be able to increase hippocampal size, but we might not be able to get rid of that pathology that's there. Right. And so I think that these are really good questions. We don't have, unfortunately, good answers, but these are my speculations at least.
Awesome. I myself have 1,000 more questions for you, but I know Steve has also been closely monitoring the audience Q&A, and so obviously need to give an opportunity for that. So Steve, do you want to jump in with some Q&A from the audience?
Sure, and I'm just glad my hyperactivity as a child may have let me start adulthood with a slightly larger hippocampus, because my guess is I have not kept that pace up on my exercise.
Go ahead. I'm going to interrupt you. Kirk, would you mind stopping your screen share?
Oh, sure.
There's been a request just to be able to, you know, see speakers. Thank you.
No problem. Awesome.
Thanks.
Yeah. First of all, Kirk, thanks so much. I mean, wow. A ton of great, very practical information. And I was so glad to see the correlation of the holistic approach to brain health, which is just, as you know, right in line with what we know and what we preach and teach here. So that was great to see that reinforced. There was a discussion and it created some questions, Kirk, about the connection with cognitive improvement in breast cancer patients. And really, is that an exercise issue? Is that a clinical issue? Is it part of this holistic thing? Could you discuss that in a little bit more detail and how that ties
in? Yeah, you know, it's a very good question. I'm glad you asked that. So I have to say that we're still in very early stages of understanding some of these associations. So generally what we know is that many women who experience breast cancer show some decline in cognitive and brain function. Now, it's not to the level of dementia, right? It's not like that significant of a degree of a drop in cognitive function, but it is a drop and it's noticeable to many, many women. Unfortunately, there's no treatments for this. And so what we've been trying to study is examining whether we could be thinking of physical activity as a way of treating these women who've been experiencing some of these losses. Like I said, we're still in the very early phases of this. Women who are experiencing breast cancer tend to show a variety of different metabolic and other physical changes that happen over the course of their treatment and recovery periods. So it does complicate the issue, does complicate matters. And I can tell you that right now I'm in the midst of finishing an intervention, a 6-month intervention to test the hypothesis that physical activity might be an effective way of improving brain, cognitive, and mood functions in women recovering from breast cancer. Now, I can't share with you any data because I'm blinded to group assignment. So we have probably about another year or so before I'm going to have any data to share with anyone about that.
Well, I'm just excited. And Jennifer, I'm going to let you jump in because I'm already envisioning some of the challenges like Jen mentioned in terms of following people longitudinally. And I would love, I'm thinking about nested studies within the Brain Health Project where you have groups, you know, it tells us we need to collect more data on exercise, right? I mean, it's just that plain and simple because we'll have participants that exercise and those that don't. And that led to one specific question, Jen, before you do, and maybe this is too confounding, Kurt, is you have diet, you have exercise, and you have brain health. Which is the biggest lever there, right? Because a lot of people use exercise as a way to have a bad diet. Have you tried to tease that out a little bit, or is that just too complex?
Yeah, it's a very interesting question and something that I alluded to with my fries.
Yep.
slide. And unfortunately there wasn't enough time for me to cover all of this information, but we know that obesity is related to numerous negative aspects of brain health. We also have growing amount of evidence that losing weight through dietary changes can have some beneficial effects. In fact, we just published a paper this past year demonstrating that people who lost weight over the course of a 12-month energy restriction diet, so a dietary intervention, actually showed increases in cerebral blood flow. So we are seeing some changes related to diet. However, there also seems to be some added benefit to exercise. There seems to be some unique benefit to exercise. And this is very, very early data on this. And in fact, there is a, there's, within the field, there's something called the fat but fit hypothesis. Basically, some people who might carry around some weight but still exercise a lot and are still very, very fit. And do these people really still continue to see the same benefits or even greater benefits? And right now, in some other areas of health, there seems to be some good evidence to suggest that remaining physically fit is, if anything, maybe more important than your weight. Now, in relation to the brain, this is a much trickier question, and we're just starting to tackle this. There's only a handful of publications, but in one publication, one paper that we published last year, fitness, cardiorespiratory fitness explained more variation in hippocampal volume than weight or obesity status. So it does seem to put some weight, no pun intended, well, kind of pun intended, but put some weight behind the importance of physical activity here.
Yeah. In fitness. Yeah. Sorry, Jen, go ahead.
No. Kirk, we have so many questions, and I know we're not going to be able to get to all of them. And I know you had earlier had graciously said that you would be willing to answer them, and then we could distribute them after the fact.
Absolutely, yeah.
Great.
Like so, I said, this is my passion, and I love the questions, and it's exciting, and I think that one of the things I also want to convey here is that there's so many unanswered questions, but that's part of why I'm so passionate. It's so exciting to be in an area where we can go in so many different directions. We can take the science in so many different directions and potentially help possibly even billions of people around the world. In fact, I have a study going on, or we're just starting a study trying to examine whether exercise might be an effective way of influencing some of the long-term effects of childhood malnutrition. And individuals who experience childhood malnutrition have developmental disorders. They have poor cognitive function, poor brain function. They also often have higher obesity rates and other things. And so we're really trying to start to examine whether physical activity might be a cost-effective approach for many of these people to improve some aspects of their performance.
There's a couple questions. A couple people have been asking questions about the impact of sitting all day long.
Yeah.
Versus like a standing desk, or just, can you talk to that?
Yeah, this is a hot area, very important. There's a phrase, sitting is the new smoking, right? That sitting for long periods, very sedentary lifestyles have a very negative effect, a very negative impact on a variety of different health outcomes. There is starting to be a growing amount of evidence that a sedentary lifestyle, sedentary behaviors also have a negative impact on the brain. We're still in the infancy of this, very early stages of this research, but there does seem to be more and more work coming out indicating that this is the case. Now, the question is how much activity do you need, or what do you need to change in order to alter that trajectory? So is it enough to just simply go from a sitting position to a standing desk? Is that going to be sufficient for altering some of the maybe negative brain consequences of sitting? We don't have good data out on this right now. So I think we really need more studies to really be confident. I would say, the other potentially challenging thing with standing desks is that one thing we do know about standing desks is that people who work by standing desks typically also move around more and walk more. And so there's some important almost confounds in some of this work, right? Because if you want to compare a standing desk versus sitting, you also have to compare the total amount of walking that those people are doing. And so there's some important design characteristics of some of the studies that need to be thought out. But in general, I'm very interested in this, and it might be an important direction for some of us to take in the coming years.
Well, and I think just specifically in COVID times when people are working from home, yeah. The amount that I used to walk every day at the office, walking up and down stairs, going to meetings, now to go to a new meeting, I just push another button and push another button, right? It's like I can sit or stand all day, but how much I'm moving is dramatically different than what it was before working from home. So I think it's really important. People still want to know exactly like, yeah, we hear 150 minutes of moderate exercise a week. What do you do?
I've been, you mentioned a few things. Some of these things, like everyone else, I had to change my patterns when COVID hit. That disrupted my life just like it disrupted everyone else's. I used to go out for runs outside all the time and still did that, still do that, but spending a lot more time indoors on my treadmill, which is actually just to the left of the screen right here. Easy access from my office. I also used to really be a gym rat, really going to the gym a lot. And my patterns have changed a bit there as well. I spend a lot more time working out at home and doing things by myself. You know, one of my own activities, one of the things that drives me, one of the things I've noticed is that we all have different drivers to adhere. As I mentioned in some of my tips at the end, is you have to find something enjoyable. One of the other things I mentioned is find a friend. But some people don't want to go and exercise with other people, and that's perfectly fine. In fact, one of the things that motivates me to exercise is getting away from work and other people, actually. It's a time where I can actually put my headphones in and ignore the world around me, essentially. I don't check the news, which can be quite troublesome at times. I don't check the news. I don't check my email. I don't hear from anyone. I'm lost in my own space, my own headspace. And that's what motivates me. So I am one where I don't want to exercise with anyone else. I want to have that alone time. So we're all different, but we need to find that space where we can really take advantage and keep going.
Well, that just reinforces to me one of my biggest takeaways is the older you get, the more important it is to have play as your mindset.
Right.
This whole idea of something that's fun. So
and as the non-clinician here, right, I'm surrounded by two brilliant people, Kirk and Jen, but it sounds to me, one of my takeaways from tonight, we talk about five-minute brain breaks a day can do so much for you. To Jen's point, why not make that a 5-minute walk while you're taking your brain break? And guess what? Do the math. You're well on your way if it's a brisk walk to getting that the minutes you need on a weekly basis. So again, I don't want to overstep my clinical skis here, but it seems to me you're killing two birds with one stone.
Yeah, you know, you're bringing up a very good point and something I want to reinforce. I mentioned earlier, maybe kind of quickly, so maybe some of you didn't hear it, but the question about whether it has to occur in 10-minute bouts. And a growing amount of data is indicating that it doesn't have to be. It's more about the total accumulation of minutes over the week. So whether you're gathering that 150 minutes in 10-minute chunks or in smaller chunks or in various different amounts, it's more about the accumulation, the total amount, rather than the length of the bout. There's nothing special about 10 minutes, nothing magical about 10 minutes. You do 5 minutes, you do 8 minutes, you do 13 minutes, 15 minutes, you're still going to get the benefits.
Well, we didn't tee this up, but the math actually works. 5 times 5 times 6 is 150. So you can still take a day off from your brain breaks and get your 150. Kirk, Perfect. We want to respect everyone's time. Jen, anything to wrap up? Let me just say a couple of things. First, as always, I've learned so much. Kirk, that's just terrific information. You really hit on a lot of points. I know we get asked a lot. So thank you very, very much. And we will look forward to sharing some additional Q&A that we could not get to. So thank you. Perfect. And I'm also inspired by my wife shared this invite with her gym girls back in Arizona. And they already are diving in to sign up for the February lecture series because now there's that thirst for knowledge. So please don't forget our February lecture series is coming up. Kirk, I'm going to hold you to it. We're going to do a nested study within the project and add some longitudinal exercise components to the data we collect. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. And to everybody who came tonight, thank you so much. Rest assured, we are going to get all the questions to Kirk and he will graciously, thank you, answer them. And we will distribute it out to everybody who attended. So you'll get to see all the questions and answers. And I just want to thank everybody for joining us tonight. Dr. Erickson, thank you. It was a great way to kick off the 21st day of the 21st year of the 21st century. So thank you for that information, Josh. So thank you so much.
Well, thank you.
Thanks, Kirk. Well done.
A lot of fun.
Awesome.
Good night, everyone.
Great. Thank you.
Thanks.